KNON 89.3 FM in Dallas and Fort Worth, the voice of the people.
Business owners, tell KNON's listeners about your business. You can put your business or event on KNON. KNON currently has space available to run announcements for you. Tell KNON's listeners about your goods, services, nightclub, concert, or event. Help keep the voice of the people on the air while putting your information on the air. KNON's been named the number one radio station in Dallas by both the Dallas Observer and D Magazine. Put your business with Dallas's number one station. Call now for more information at 214-828-9500, extension 227, or extension 233. For more information, go to KNON.org and click on the Run Spots on KNON page. It's a great way for your business to support community radio while letting more people know about you.
Hi, and welcome to Lambda Weekly, the December 20th issue of Lambda Weekly. I'm David Taffet in the studio with Lerone Landis and the late Patti Fink, who has lost her voice.
And the reason I'm not talking is I don't have a voice.
Oh, boy. It's a really festive time right around here at KNON today. So we want to tell you, before we get to our guests, we want to tell everyone about the toy drive that KNON is having. We're having a toy drive that's collecting toys for Children's Medical Center. And you can drop your toys off at several different spots. Here at the station, which is our new station, is 11311 North Central Expressway. You can also drop it off at La Hacienda Furniture, Top 10 Records, Sons of Herman Hall, and Vetos Locos Tattoos. So there's several different places, and they're collecting toys all the way up until 4 o'clock. Again, just drop off one or two toys, and it's going to a great cause at Children's Medical Center.
And we're having lots of fun here.
Having lots of fun. There's food to eat.
There's live music outside.
Live music outside. There's a car show, apparently.
My car's, I think it's going to be in it.
Oh.
I found a parking spot, but I think it's in the middle of the show.
Oh, boy. Well, the Prius might take it. So, you can drop off toys anywhere up until 4 o'clock or here at the station at KNON 11311 North Central Expressway. And if you have any questions, give us a call. What's that number, Patti?
972-647-1893.
All right. Give us a call if you've got any questions about the toy drive. A couple of weeks ago, we told you all about a brand new film festival that was taking place here in Dallas called Rack Focus. It's created by local and openly gay filmmaker Israel Luna, and we have the winners here. We have two of the three winners here, Billy Weaver and Michelle Neat, and we're going to talk a little about the film festival and their films. Welcome. Thank you all for coming.
I really appreciate it. Thank you.
And Billy, and you're also here with Ashley Weaver. She's the assistant director, correct?
Yes, she's the assistant director,
the
script supervisor,
and the assistant
kind of
daughter.
And she's my daughter.
She's your daughter.
Oh, I thought assistant daughter.
I love that. Family filmmaking team. So your film was called The Caravan.
Correct.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, the way I pitched it was that it's a post-apocalyptic film without gasoline and zombies. So no Mad Max stuff, no Walking Dead stuff. It's a, and it just follows the life of a man whose wife was taken by a group of bandits in this world known as the Caravan, and his search to try to get her back, to find out what's happened to her. And the short itself, we've kind of gotten away from calling it a short film. And more or less, we call it the prelude. You know, it's like the beginning of what the Caravan will eventually be.
Yeah, because I saw the film. Good job, by the way. Congratulations on your win. I wanted more. I'm like, oh, it's ending. So, I don't want to call it a film shorts, but that's ultimately what Rack Focus was.
Correct.
It was a 10-minute limit?
Yeah, 10 minutes, start to finish. You had 3 months from the time you pitched it, the film, to shoot it, edit, and get it submitted. And I know people are like, 3 months, that's a long time. Well, yeah, if you've never shot you've never done a short film, you'll understand that 3 months is
Not a lot of time.
Yeah, it's not a lot of time to do the whole thing. But
so you have this term guerrilla filmmaking. Tell us about that.
Pardon me?
There's a term guerrilla filmmaking.
Guerrilla filmmaking.
Tell us about that.
I get that from Robert Rodriguez, one of my favorite filmmakers. You know, he talks about guerrilla filmmaking quite a bit, and it's a lot of run and gun and shooting filming, and that's what I like. That's what I enjoy doing. You know, just being able to, I grab a camera, got a story, got my actors, let's go, let's just get it done, let's, you know, move as fast as you can and as cheap as you can. We're filmmakers, so you know it's a tough market to break into. So.
And go into a place where you weren't supposed to be to even film.
Sometimes.
Illegal filmmaking.
I shot down in Deep Ellum, and we took up a lot of space, and so we sort of had everything set up before getting the shot, and so then we just ran out real fast, got the shots, and then we hurried up and jumped back in our cars, took off. This was another short, not this one, but yeah. Sometimes you just have to do it.
So The Caravan isn't your film first film.
This is the first film I've directed, and you know, just directed.
Gotcha.
You know, I've written several films, edited more films than I can even remember, but this is the first film that all my role was. I wrote the film. I also did the editing, but my role on set was just as the director. This is the first time I've ever just been the director on set, and you know, I didn't have a camera in my hand, and I didn't have, you know.
So in a typical film, 2 hour, 90 minutes, 45 minutes film, you know, there's a lot of footage that's actually shot that people aren't aware of, and then they dwindle it down to the hour and 45 minutes. How much footage did you actually shoot, and then whittled it down to 10 minutes? Actually, I think it was around 8 and some minutes.
Oh, God, how much footage did I
Yeah,
have?
A lot.
Yeah,
probably enough to make that 90-minute.
Really? Okay. And was that hard, difficult, the editing? Like, oh, I want to keep this, but I don't have enough time, or?
There's a one of the hardest things I think that a filmmaker can do is edit his own film. Because there's a term in the industry, it's called cutting your baby. And so there, you look at everything and you go, no, all of it's great. All of this is great. I want to keep all of it in there. But you can't. So you have to cut your baby. You have to remove bits and pieces of the film. And that's difficult. You know, I was proud of every bit of footage we had. You know, I wanted to use it all. But...
Well, and you have to be careful, too, because are there going to be plot holes? Are there going to be... I mean, it has to be a continuum for the viewer.
Right.
You know,
right.
To be able to understand what's going on in the film and the point
that,
of it.
That's, you know, that people don't realize that editing a film is just as important as shooting the film and everything else, because you're exactly right. You have to be able to make sure there's a good flow and it all kind of makes sense, you know.
That's why there are awards for editors. You know?
Oh, absolutely.
I see you have an award. If you could hold that up to the mic, our listeners could then see the award you won.
No, I carry this with me. Everywhere I go, I shower with it, I sleep with it.
Oh,
can I see it?
Huh?
Can I see it?
No.
Oh,
no.
I won't drop it, I promise.
No.
That's pretty nice.
Yes.
Closest thing I'll ever hold to an Oscar. That's pretty nice.
I don't let this thing out of my sight. I have, I keep it in the front seat, seat belt, you know, over it.
We had to move so it could have its own room.
I got a third bedroom.
You
now.
Came strapped to the hood of the car. I was wondering what that was about, Ashley. But
well, because it gets shotgun now.
Uh-huh.
So.
Oh, okay, okay.
No, I'm extremely proud of this, for not only for the work we did as a team, because I'm proud of what we put out. I really am. But you're going to talk to Michelle and the guys here in a little bit. They had an incredible movie. There are so many great filmmakers and so many great entries in this competition that this means a lot more to me, simply because, I mean, again, you just saw her film.
Yeah, I did.
So you know what
I
I'm
did.
Talking about.
Yes.
And so it's that's why it means a lot more. It's not necessarily the fact that, you know, we just won up, because if you know, win, lose, or draw, it doesn't matter. I'm proud of what we put out, and I'm extremely proud of my cast and crew. And but
is this your first film festival to enter?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
we did what's called Demonic Chronic. Joseph Spector, who won third, and he was supposed to be here today. I think.
We're going to try and get him on for
holidays. It's kind of tough for him. And again, another phenomenal filmmaker. They do a thing called Demonic Chronic, and I was part of a team that entered in, you know, one of theirs. Mm-hmm. But this is the actual first film festival that's my, you know, that everything about it was, you know. My film, I wrote it, I directed it, I did the casting and everything else. So,
and so where do you go from here? Any full length feature films in the works?
Yes.
Oh,
that's
good.
That was what this whole thing was about. Anthony Gutierrez with Sticky Feet Studios, who was also my DP, he and I talked quite a bit. I've lucked out because I had not only did my film win Best Film, but my actor, Joshua Briscoe, won Best Male Actor, and Chance Gibbs won Best Supporting Male Actor, and I've been lucky enough with both of them wanting to stay a part of the film, even in the feature, as well as the incredible Anthony Gutierrez, who's a phenomenal DP. He wants to shoot it.
But one thing you said before the show was you're not going to be able to use any of the footage that you already have.
Why not?
Technically, I could.
You could.
I could.
But
I think we've all agreed we want to reshoot it. I mean, I think we, you know, I think we want to reshoot the and not because of.
But you have a good reason.
Yeah, I mean, you're dealing. Okay, Josh and Chance and Melina, if you are listening. Turn off the radio now. what happens when you're dealing with actors, sorry, Michelle, when you're dealing with actors is on a whim, they'll just change their hair. Or I want my hair to be this now.
Well,
and I want to look like,
in between, they might have had a different role.
Pardon me?
They might have had a different role.
But that's also another thing. You know, they might get a different role. I know that Joshua had several roles. You know, I told him I wanted you ragged looking. But he had roles. He couldn't look that way.
When I was doing my stupid acting career, I mean, I always wanted, you know, I got lots of calls. I just couldn't fill all of those. Because, you know,
such demand for.
I know. I was working on Friday Night Lights. I just couldn't do, you know, everything else.
Well, I must say that as a film critic myself, there's nothing worse than watching a film with horrible continuity. So, yes, you got to keep it the same.
I thought he was going to say horrible acting and point to some of the things I've done.
That too.
Well, that was one of the reasons. So, and we want to reshoot it. I mean.
And can you talk a little bit about, you know, money? Even if you did it on a cheap, filmmaking still costs.
Yes.
Did you do it out of your own pocket? Did you raise money? Have fun?
No, it came out of pocket.
Yeah.
There's no raising money for this.
Beg, steal.
Pardon me?
Beg and steal.
Beg, steal, borrow, yeah.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Rob Peter to pay Paul.
Yeah.
Bless my daughter's heart. I didn't feed her for a while. I mean, that's okay. She has to suffer for my craft. Wait, now that's not how the saying, but anyway, she suffered.
That's it.
Yeah, and so for the feature, which, you know, is going to be incredibly, I'm lucky enough to have, you know, a very healthy 20-year-old daughter, so I figured, you know, we could sell a kidney, get the feature done. So I have plans.
So for later on, I've always loved film shorts, especially animated film shorts, and you always see them when you go to movies, then they show them right before the movie starts. When this is over with, well, it is over with, the Rack Focus Film Festival, is there any place people can see your films? Your shorts, same thing with you later on, Michelle. I'll ask you the same thing. Is there any place we can see them?
Well, again, it all depends. And we're also considering entering another festival.
Okay.
With that being the case, then
you got to hold out.
Not right now.
Okay.
You're more than welcome to go to the Caravan Inciting Incident Films Facebook page and see the trailer and, you know, kind of the teaser and get excited about it. And but right now, we're still a lot of it is we're still processing the win. I mean, you know, when Chance Gibbs won Best Supporting Male Actor, I was like, you know, that made my night. Let's, you know, it can end now. And right. Then Joshua Briscoe won Best Male Actor. I was like, that made my night. It can end now because I'm proud of both of them. They're incredible actors.
And where did you find your actors? Did you have auditions, or you just knew them already?
I knew them already. Okay. I had worked with Chance and Joshua both. Melina Lyon, it killed me to put her in this film. And the reason why is because she is such an incredible actor. And she had, as you saw, her role was so minimal.
It was.
Even though her story and what happens in the feature, it's huge. But I was like, oh, I feel bad even trying to put her in, but
there are no small roles.
Pardon me?
There are no small roles.
There's no small roles.
That's what David's been told for years.
Only directors who don't know how to properly use us.
So I didn't. I had never worked with Melina before, but she. I think The Notebook.
Nope.
Anyway, but she. She was phenomenal, and you know, hopefully. A lot of hand signals happening. Mm-hmm.
No, none of you. We're talking to Lerone, who's ignoring us.
Oh. All right. We are coming up on a break.
Okay.
We need to take a break, and we'll be back with more Lambda Weeklies and talking to the winners of the Rack Focus Film Festival.
This is Janice McCall from TCU, and I listen to Lambda Week on 89.3 KNON FM, Dallas.
And welcome back to Lambda Weekly. I'm David Taffet in the studio with Lerone Landis and the late Patti Fink, who's lost her voice. Today we're talking with some winners of the Rack Music Festival, Rack Film Festival. Film Festival.
Focus.
You know, I'm David today, so it's right. Okay.
And David's voice has lowered. I mean, went much higher, much, much higher. So anyway, we're talking to the winners of the Rack Focus Film Festival. And up next, we have Michelle Neat, Brandon Conwell, and Christian Kramer. Pownall, I'm sorry. And they are here for their film, Hands Cover Bruise. Welcome.
Hi, guys.
Happy to be here.
Very excited.
Hello.
Very honored.
So who's actually the director?
Me and Christian shared the directing duties for this time.
Yeah. Okay. So you all received, did you get second or third?
We got second best film, and we got out of the...
Outside the box.
Outside the box concept.
Oh, yeah,
we were
nice.
The only...
Oh,
wow. The film is silent, and it's in black and white. So
wow.
We were the only silent and black and white film in the race.
Yeah, and I love that part of it. I love that. Yeah, so congratulations.
Thank
so,
you.
Whose concept? Who wrote it?
That would be all this one right here, Michelle.
Me, a concept, because it was a thing that actually happened to me in real life, and I guess because it was such a traumatic thing, I always imagined it. It was inspired by a song from this Social Network soundtrack, which is what we titled the film after.
Oh, okay.
And so I just always kind of, the playback of that experience was always just in black and white and like in silent, because when a traumatic experience like that happens.
Mm-hmm. Can you share the experience?
The experience, it's about, there was one day a couple years ago where it was a family situation where I had a, family member I found in the bathroom that was overdosing on heroin, and I had to then call 911, and they had already been they were just really struggling with an addiction, and it was I found them in the bathroom, and then they kind of came out of their like heroin stupor, and we got in like a, I was trying to keep them in the house so the ambulance could get there and the police could get there so they could get help, and like we got into a physical altercation.
Wow.
And I mean, the ambulance and stuff arrived before then, but just the entire, any time I had to remember or relive that experience, it always, there was no sound. And like in my brain, like there was no sound. It just always happened in black and white because it was just such a horrific thing. But overall, this film was, with the help of these brilliant, brilliant men sitting next to me, it was very therapeutic and cathartic. It was such an important, I think the reason why that this means, that winning everything meant so much is because it was such an important story to tell.
Wow. So prior to this, have any of you had any filmmaking experience?
This is actually our second short film. Our first one, we entered in a student festival at our school. It was called The Horror Film Race, and we had a week to film that, and that came out pretty well.
Nice. And was that also a film short?
Yes, sir. It was only like 3 minutes long, so it was the shortest one in the race.
Yeah, that really is short.
Yeah, but we ended up winning. We took home best film, so it worked out.
Okay, so I'm going to try to croak this out. I'm really having trouble talking at all. Okay, so Michelle, they directed what happened to you, and as the actress in the film, you were able to play the part as you saw it. Were they directing you correctly, incorrectly? Were there ever arguments about, no, that's not how
there
it
was
happened?
Never, I know, because they're very, like, they're extremely talented. Like, it's not just them, just everyone on the set was very talented, very focused, like, and they went into it knowing how personal it was. So I came to them with, they did this all in 2 weeks, because originally I had everything set up. I had, you know, directors, actors. They got poached from me, like, taken from me, worked on another project, and I came to them with only 2 weeks, and they made this all happen in 2 weeks. And there was never any arguments, because I came to them and we talked about the story. Talked about the story beforehand, and I just kind of like, there were some points where I said there are some definite, there are definite things that like, I want this to happen, but overall I left it up to these brilliant minds, because they made this, they were just great, because I didn't have to argue, because they understood the bit. It's like everyone kind of understood what we were trying to accomplish on screen.
Okay, so that's what she's saying. Now she can't hear what we're talking about now. Tell us how she was to work with.
Oh, man, she was terrible. Just a nightmare. She always wanted stuff on set. She wanted her own trailer.
I did. On trailer, you know, non-fat, decaf, yeah, lattes.
Diva.
She tried to take her title. It's like, I want to direct it now. Let me do it.
She wanted to play. She wanted to play both parts. She wanted to play her brother and herself.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it was a nightmare. But we got it done, and we're so talented together that we ended up making up for all her mistakes, and
I
it came out
it.
Really well.
Yeah, but in the end, we were just like, we stuck our heads together. We pulled this off. 2 weeks. It was pretty hectic, I'd say. Yeah,
we got the idea, and then the whole first week we wrote the script, did the pre-production, planned it all out. That weekend we filmed it, and then the week after that we edited it, we sent it to our colorist and he added colors in, because we wanted to like have everything in black and white except for the things that are important. We wanted to put those in color.
Yeah, I saw the bracelet was blue.
The hospital bracelet was blue.
Yeah, that was pretty neat.
And like they were so careful in planning this out, so they think like everything in that film had a purpose and a reason. So like the hospital bracelet was kind of like a signal, or like a, to kind of to clue people in that this isn't a first experience, like this is a reoccurring problem. And that was actually that was actually their idea, and I was like, that's perfect, that's brilliant. And there's a point where there are lights, red and blue lights that are in color, and that was actually that was their idea. But I'm gonna let them take over from here to explain that shot.
Oh yeah, the ending shot we actually came up with together. It was awesome, because we were planning on getting an ambulance, and it was such short notice that we couldn't find one. So we were like, okay, we need to write a new ending now. So we went on location, did location scouting, and then my directing partner Christian Kramer right here came up with the great idea of him giving up. And I don't want to give away the ending, but, you know, basically he came up with the ending, and then I came up with the idea of having it from her point of view and showing it from, like, lower of the ground and just, like, have him walk out of focus. And you guys will see what I'm talking about whenever we release the film online in a few months. But
oh, good.
It was a great experience. And
so everyone will have an opportunity to see it.
Yes, sir. We want to enter it in a few more festivals first. And we may be entering in a showcase, we don't know yet, for DIFF. So we're trying to figure that out right now. But after we get everything situated, it will be online for sure.
And was the whole film shot here in Dallas?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Shot at his aunt's house.
Oh, nice.
Did you do anything illegal?
No, man. We didn't have to do anything illegal this time.
Nothing illegal.
Well, thank you, aunt.
Yet.
So, yeah. You know, indie filmmakers, I know it costs. How did you all scrape your money together?
The movie cost about, what, 150, maybe 200 bucks to make. We did it super cheap.
Nice.
So,
it was such a simple, the thing is, like, it was such...
We borrowed all the equipment.
It's
we,
all about networking. You always got to find the good resources that you can use whenever they're there for you. You know?
Shout out to our my amazing co-star, Colton Tapp. He killed it. He stepped in, and it was, I couldn't have imagined anyone else playing that role. He nailed it, and then our brilliant photographer, Malia Johnson.
And not to mention our sound guy, the most important thing is to get the feel of the whole thing. Our sound guy, John Townsend.
So great.
And my beautiful girlfriend, who was also the assistant director on the film.
Yeah,
she
did
Kaylin.
Wonderful.
Yeah, Kaylin Poe.
And we had some eye candy, too. Well, at least I did, so that was good. I'm just kidding. She's very smart and talented.
Okay, so I'm guessing that you didn't do this in, like, 8 millimeter.
No, sir.
We'll talk about that when Matthew comes back. Because before you came in, Lerone, we were talking about making a film and how we used to do it, like, when I was in college, where you had to take the actual film and actually
slice it. Yeah.
And you sliced and you pasted it together. So you didn't have any of that, huh?
No, sir.
It was,
it was all digital, on the computer, on an SD card. So.
Oh, nice.
Which is amazing. That makes filmmaking so much more available to more people.
Absolutely.
Now because those things are available.
So did you all shoot the film or get the idea before the film festival was announced, the contest was announced, or was this already in works?
I pitched the idea. Originally I wasn't and then I met them a couple of months after the pitch meeting mixer, because how it works with Rack Focus is after the premiere of the previous round, there's about a month break, and then in mid-January, there'll be another mixer pitch session. And then you have 3 months from, you cannot start production on the film. You can, write the script, you can do, small pre-production stuff, but you can't actually start production on the film until after the pitch meeting, so the day after the pitch meeting.
Oh, interesting. And okay.
So when your 3 month timeline starts.
Yeah, you have a 3 month timeline, and then you have a submission deadline, and you have to turn it in. Like, if you don't complete your project, then that kind of puts you in hot water with Rack Focus from then on out. You pay your $100 entry fee, and then the premiere happens, and it's usually it's a 2-night premiere. I get it might be because I feel like the festival is only growing stronger and stronger. And then you have that the 2-night premiere, and then they have the awards right after the last night of the premiere.
So this isn't like other film festivals where you could have a film that's maybe a year or two old and submit it.
It's kind of like a film race, but it's also a film festival, almost kind of mixed together, kind of.
And
so,
when you receive feedback, it's all positive feedback or ways you can improve. So it's all, also like a giant you're workshopping with others and networking, and it's a really positive environment for. Because you can only improve from where you started, so it's not like you'll ever digress in your filmmaking.
So how long has Rack Focus Film Festival been taking place?
It just 2015.
Yeah,
second round, first year.
This is the first year. So heading into January will be round three.
Wow. Yeah. So this really is a competition. It's on your mark, get set, go.
Go
exactly.
And it's just you have to make sure you have the right people around you.
And how does that work with, everybody's creative juices flow a little differently, but that pressure, some people like being under that pressure, some people don't. How did you all deal with
that? We've never done a film where we weren't under that pressure. Our first film, we had a week to shoot, to write, to shoot, to edit, and then turn it in at the end of the week. We had 9 days, so a little over a week. And then this film, we had 3 months, but we ended up getting the idea 2 weeks before it was due, so we had 2 weeks. So we've never actually have been comfortable, had enough time to go out and film, and then take a couple months to edit. We've never had to do that yet. Our next project, hopefully, we'll have a lot more
time. So what are you guys doing for 6 weeks?
I don't know what she was doing. She came to us 2 weeks before it was due.
I still wanted the project to happen. I had everything pretty beautifully set up before it was taken out from underneath me.
Gotcha.
I'm a
said poaching incident.
Poaching incident, yes. Poaching should be illegal, especially in the film community.
Yeah, but everything happens for a reason.
And I feel like it should have never happened any other way but with these guys. It was a gorgeous production team, a beautiful experience. It was a very like a 12, it was a 12-hour day, but I mean, we shot it all in one day, and it wouldn't have been possible.
We're so grateful that she didn't have anybody else to go to where she had to come to us, because we love the film, and it came out really great, so.
That's awesome.
So where do you go from here?
Well, we have another film right now that we're finishing the script on, and.
Right now it's called Dante, where
Let's not give away too many of the plot lines.
We're not going to really say anything about it just yet. But right now we're trying to shoot it in March. And luckily, I have a good friend. Her name is Cooper London. Who turns out her father is Jason London from Dazed and Confused.
Lead role from Dazed and Confused, yes, sir.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so...
Will it be a film short also?
It'll be a lot longer. It'll be like 15 minutes, but still
okay.
Short.
Yeah,
so that it won't be in the next Rack Focus, but I mean, who knows? We might do the next round. We just don't know from here. But definitely, they're working on Dante.
We're not going to rush this one. We're going to film it and take our time.
Yeah, so. We're not going to try to shoot everything in one day.
Yeah. No.
Awesome. And with the film that you've done, what are you planning on doing with the film now?
I don't know, guys.
We're going to look into other festivals, mm-hmm. and a lot of the bigger ones are, the dates already due. So we're just going to look around, find out where the best place for it would be. And I don't know, we showed it to one of our teachers at our art school, and he liked it. So he's going to see if he can get it into the showcase at DIFF. So that
Dallas
would be cool.
That'd
be
Dallas
International Film Festival. That'd be a great networking opportunity. We wouldn't be eligible for any awards, but it would be awesome to just be there.
So where do you guys go to school?
We go to the Art Institute of Dallas.
Nice.
Right on Park Lane, right over there.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. Nice.
Okay, so for somebody who would love to make this into a career, do you consider this film to be a good thing for your portfolio, or is there a way to make...
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so you'd like to go on and do what?
Other things with continue on in film because keep telling still do like a variety of genres, but also make sure that every time you make a film, because the story was very important and I feel like needed to be told, and everyone kind of felt that way, so I just want to continue to make those important pieces that like with stories that need to be told, stories that matter.
So you start in this film. So yes. Do you have more interest in the acting or the actual film
amazing
production?
Actress, by the way.
I want it all.
I want to do it all. Nothing wrong with that. And what about you guys? Do you do any acting?
We're actually into directing. I'm a terrible actor. I had to do it for like a student project, and it was god awful. So I'm never doing that again. Hopefully.
No, hopefully.
You should check in with David. He can give you some tips.
Oh yeah, that'd be awesome.
I have great terrible acting skills.
And you?
I dabble a little because my little sister's actually an actress, Victoria Kramer, and she's pretty wonderful, so I'm trying to actually just keep up with her.
Gotcha.
But as far as I know, I'd like to throw myself in for a few cameos, producing, directing, and then acting in just small parts.
Right. Yeah.
I'm gonna CGI my face onto his body so I can have my cameo and he'll just act for me. I'm not good on camera.
Yeah.
Well, we do want to remind everybody, KNON is having a toy drive right now as we speak. We're collecting toys for Children's Medical Center, and they can be dropped off at four different locations. You can do it here at the KNON studio at 11311 North Central Expressway. You can also do it at La Hacienda Furniture, Top 10 Records, or at Sons of Herman Hall. We're there a lot. So yeah, bring a toy, bring two or three toys, and have some good food here while you're visiting.
And that 11311 North Central Expressway is actually on the west side of Central Expressway at North Haven.
Yes.
So right on the corner. You can't miss us. The parking lot's full.
It is full.
So, find a parking space on the street or further down next door and come on over. We've got live music in the parking lot.
And a car show if you're into cars.
I'm not sure what happened to the live music, though.
I still hear it.
Do you hear it?
Yeah.
Oh, well, maybe my ears are.
Oh, yeah, because you're losing your voice and your ears.
I was talking before the show to a friend of mine who's deaf, and he was actually talking about coming in for me and doing sign language, which I thought would be perfect on the radio.
Great. Yeah, on the radio would be perfect.
He said he was going to have all of his deaf friends listen today.
That's
awkward.
Awesome. Good joke, that man.
Okay, if you guys,
you think I'm kidding. this friend's name, his name is David, he said, oh, sure, all you know, we have never listened to your show before, but today might be the day.
Should I be the first? All right. And if you have any questions, give us a call at 972-647-1893, because they're collecting all the way up until 4 o'clock today. So you still got time.
Why don't we take our break?
Okay.
Okay. We'll be back with more Lambda Weekly right after this.
This is Jason Wright from Dallas, and I listen to Lambda Week 89.3K.
And welcome back to Lambda Weekly. I'm Lerone Landis here with Patti Fink, the late Patti Fink.
Actually, that's not what the sheet says. It says David Taffet.
No, but
you took my pad, and what did I write on the top of it? It said, I'm David Taffet. Now, please read it.
Okay. Welcome to Lambda Weekly. I'm David Taffet.
Thank you.
Here with the late Patti Fink and the horse, David Taffet.
You're always calling me a whore.
Horse is better.
I'm not hearing right.
We have to talk to Brian about the whore thing. So, but anyway, so let's get back. We're talking to the Rack Focus Film Festival winners. And we have Billy Weaver. Again, he's the director of The Caravan. And Michelle Neat, who starred in and helped create Hands Cover Brews.
So, you know, years ago, it used to be just in the film industry at large that, you know, the big studios ran everything. I can remember as a child, you know, like looking at the Oscars and stuff. And if there was an indie film, it was shunned at the Oscars. It was shunned at the Golden Globes. I mean, it took a long time, you know, decades there for indie films to really have their own. And I think they've really come to the fore.
Well, now they're the thing.
They are the thing.
I mean, if you have an indie film, that probably has a better chance of winning an Oscar nowadays.
Do you think that's opened up the industry in a good way, or you think there are too many films?
I think it's empowering. It empowers individuals because it's now the industry. I feel, at least in my experience, because I have my hands in a couple of other like pieces of the entertainment industry. It's empowering because instead of somebody coming to you. You coming to someone and saying, hey, you know, help me out, make my career. You make your own career. You control your own destiny, and you're a content creator instead of somebody else being a content creator for you. You control it. I feel like the way the industry is turning, it's more empowering for individuals instead of like giant studio heads.
It's kind of the same way with music. I mean, like, there's a lot of outlets you can get your music out there too.
Absolutely.
to be heard. And it's not the big stuff like we, you know, see in the olden days where, you know, like everybody's seen this film, or, you know, but if you have a following that's substantial, then you're doing really well.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I think,
cool.
You know, like she said, she's 100% correct. It is empowering for new filmmakers. Sorry.
That's good.
New filmmakers. And especially, you know, because of how attainable it is. You mentioned earlier about it being a lot easier. David, you and I talked about 8mm films.
We really did. And one thing you said, I said, how did you get started? He said, well, it was always a dream of mine.
Well, yeah, it was always a dream of mine, you know, but, you know, I grew up poor, so it was unattainable. You know, we didn't have the thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars you needed to get, you know, to really be able to do it. Now, you could take a couple of grand and go down and get a decent camera, and, you know, a subscription to Adobe, you know, Creative Cloud, and you get all your editing software, and boom.
You don't have to keep running your film to the film developer,
right,
and bringing it back, taking a look at it, seeing, oh, well, that didn't work out, so now we have to film it over again.
Well, you know, you
that
say,
doesn't
you know,
happen anymore.
You can just take a couple of $1,000 and go down and get a good camera, you know, but anybody can jump in here and answer this. Talk about how has technology changed the way filmmaking is made and made it more accessible to anybody, because correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't there a full-length film that was made on a cell phone?
Robert Rodriguez, again, I go back to Robert Rodriguez. Robert Rodriguez did a thing where he did a film competition where it was all, you know, using the Android Galaxy phones.
Yeah, that's what I got. No, yeah, no, go ahead.
I was going to say, like, Mark Duplass, he's like a very good independent filmmaker. He always says, like, if you ever have the time every weekend, just go out with an iPhone, Android, whatever, go shoot a movie. He's actually won so many awards just from his independent films shot only on phones.
Wow.
Mark Duplass, isn't he also the guy that's on The League?
I know him like more like a, like he was like Jeff who lives at home, Cyrus, like he was the actor for the Lazarus Effect, you know, that guy. His brother
Jay Duplass, I think, is on Transparent, which is on Amazon Prime.
I mean, I remember the last Rack Focus, for example. Remember Alan Dunkel, who won Out of the Box with his short Wildflowers. It was great. He came up on, you know, when he came to get the award, he had this little bitty Canon, just tiny little camera around his neck. You know, it wasn't even a full like size DSLR, and he's like, our entire film was shot with this, you know. So it's become, you know, you can use your smartphones, you can use your iPads. We've actually used my iPad for some video, and you know, it's everybody. You've got it right there.
Yeah,
you can make a film right there.
And
I think the one thing that technology has done has really made the story now is what's, you know, is more important. Is how well the story is put together, how well it's written, because everybody's making films. You go to YouTube and type in, you know, short film, and you're going to be there for weeks watching some really good ones, some really bad ones, you know. But everybody's a filmmaker today.
Yeah.
And so now I think it's what technology has done is made it where the story has to stand out.
Yeah. One of the things that always used to happen on a set was, hold it, cut, have to reload the film.
Yeah.
Cut, have to reload the film. And you'd have to, like, physically take the film out of the camera, put the new film in the camera. You don't have to do that anymore.
Mm-mm.
I mean, sometimes you have to click out one card and put in another one, but it's...
Batteries.
SD card, change batteries.
Or batteries.
Change battery.
Does anybody yell your print?
A lot of the terminology is still the same. We're still, quote-unquote, filmmakers. Uh-huh. But I think Mel Brooks said it best when he was asked about being a filmmaker. He said, I'm not a filmmaker. Kodak is a filmmaker. I make movies. But we still use a lot of the same terms. We still call it prints. You know, we have our print sheets. We still call filmmakers. Yeah, I mean, a lot of the stuff.
It's in the can, you know.
Yeah, right.
Now, during the film festival, did many of the directors and actors, did they kind of know each other? Or was there like a little... fierce competition between you two?
No, that's the thing is, I don't ever look at...
She and I duked it out in the alley.
We fought before. Filmmakers Fight Club, but we're not supposed to talk about that.
Yeah,
but still.
I'm sorry. Sorry, Israel, we weren't supposed to talk about that.
Shh, that's our best kept secret. But no, I feel like I went into it looking as like I'm very proud of everyone there, because it takes a lot of courage and effort to do something like this, to tell a story. And so I viewed nobody as a competitor. I viewed somebody, they're all of our peers. And I was familiar with some of the people, but we got to just meet and I got to expand my network. And I feel like it's just a meeting of creative minds, and it's like the best kind of connection to make.
It's like saying they're all one of us.
Yeah, yeah. These are my people.
Yeah. Well, you know, sometimes when you get a bunch of, you know, musicians together, a lot of the different ideas start to bounce off one another. Next thing you know, they're teaming up and making new music. I just wondered if it's the same way with some of the filmmakers.
True. I think competition or like unpleasant. What separates people who are going to be successful and who are not going to be successful is dropping that attitude that competition or you have to be negative towards one another, because there is enough success in this world for everyone.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know, and that's a real Dallas attitude toward it. That is so much not a California attitude.
Oh, no.
I can't tell you how many times I was on a set, because I've been on lots and lots of sets, and there were some California actors mixed in, and the Dallas actors are, oh, so where did you hear about this? Oh, I got it through so-and-so. Where did you get it? Oh, I got it through so-and-so. You know, you need to call so-and-so, my manager. There was lots of that. And the California actors were looking at us having this conversation in horror. They were like, you tell each other?
Well, the thing is, treatment goes a long way.
That's a Dallas attitude, though.
Building relationships and treatment, a good treatment of others. And that's my number one principle is treating others well, because that's going to go miles.
The other argument I got into, and it was... I'm thinking of one particular day where we had this conversation, and then these California actors are like, well, why are they picking you to be the stand-in for the
lead actor, because I was doing, you know, by stand-in, it's the person who stands there and they do the lighting and everything else off of you. Why are they picking you? And I said, well, because this director knows that when he tells me to do something, I just do it.
You just shut your mouth with no attitude.
Exactly. No attitude, nothing. And they knew the
That's
California.
That's not a Dallas thing. I can promise you I've worked with a lot of actors that aren't, that are from Dallas that that won't do that. I'm not naming names.
No,
that won't do that. That's
and,
not
a consummate professionals.
That's,
but
that's
I
just
agree.
A character thing. Yeah,
I agree.
I've also worked with some great actors, by the way, Joshua Briscoe, Melina Lyon, Chance Gibbs, that are just like you said. But yeah, you know, there's some divas in Dallas. Don't.
Of course,
there's always some are exceptions.
But I found the ones who were the most successful. And the filmmakers who were the most successful were the ones who shared things because, ooh, I have a project coming up where I really, that person that I met, and that was the best way to network. You know, that's where you'll meet other actors or whatever for your next film. That's where you'll meet, you know, other,
and
whatever
it
is that you need.
And I'm more apt to work with somebody, like Michelle just said, you know, how they treat other people, because I'm not really hard nosed on set. I almost made you push your button. I almost said a bad word, but I'm not really that tough on set or anything like that. And so I want to work with people that treat well other people. It doesn't matter how good you are. I don't, you know, your talent is your talent, and you can be, you know, you can be considered the greatest actor or actress in Dallas, and if you're a jerk, well, you're not going to work with me, you know.
So we were talking earlier about Rack Focus just having this round three coming up.
Yes. Round three,
and the pitch meetings are going to be in January.
Yep.
So when can we see some more film? 3 months from then.
3 months from then, yeah. Of course, there's always a bunch of like different film projects going on. Dallas is, people are like, well, there's nothing going on in Dallas. I go, okay, well, you guys don't look hard enough. There's always something going on. This Christian here, sitting next to me, he's the networking king, so he knows just everybody. And I just, it's a very, I guess, like, the biggest thing is you're going to see more film, but, you know, remaining humble and grateful and, like, realizing that, like, it's a privilege to do this. It's a privilege to be able to tell stories and make films. So.
Absolutely.
Well, is there a market for these films, though? And by a market, I mean one where you can make some money off of short films.
There. Go ahead.
I would say possibly in the very distant future. Like, most filmmakers, they always have to start out with shorts. You know, you have to get the feel for it. That's what me and Brandon
it's a great
are
way
to
learn.
Too, you know?
Yeah.
It's like we're trying to hit every genre to feel know what we're feeling comfortable with. And eventually, when we feel comfortable with everything we've done, we'll start a feature. And we have to make it up. And then in the future, you know, one day when we someday hopefully get, you know, famous and have to release it, like, we'll possibly do, like, DVD resales and stuff. That's how we can get it all back.
You know, for documentary makers who made short docs, what was Al Gore's station? Current TV was a great market for that kind of thing. And then they went away.
Mm-hmm. Or bought out.
Well, they went away. they got bought out.
They're
just for
there.
Their bandwidth, but
yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
Is there a market for them somewhere like in between HBO films that are, you know,
yeah,
an hour and whatever?
It's a small market. He's correct. I mean, you really. If you go back and you look at, you know, Martin Scorsese's first short, The Shave. You know, I mean, and you watch that, and then you go, wow, that was Martin Scorsese. You could see his style when he in that short, but then, boom, he blows up. There is a market now, thanks to, again, going back to technology. You've got Vimeo, YouTube, Netflix, HBO, Showtime, all of them have short, you know, it's become a big category at the Oscars and at the Emmys. You've got these short categories. Are we gonna be the next Martin Scorsese because we dedicate our lives to making shorts? No, you know, he's right. You gotta, I think that was the perfect attitude to be able to work with every genre and get a feel in the shorts and how, you know, and how the process goes before you actually make your feature.
Yeah, like what works best.
There is a small market. Yeah.
Now, these young folks are in school. You did not go to school for filmmaking.
Pardon me?
Did you go to school for filmmaking?
No.
Now, how important is it going to school or just getting out there and learning on the job?
Seriously, are you going to make me say that with two young people that are in school right now?
No. I actually have a lot to say about that, too. It's like, huh?
What?
Is that even in art school, it's, for me and Brandon, like, we were very surprised at this Rack Focus round, too, of how many people weren't in film school but did such an amazing job. Yep. As they're like, first-timers there. They did such a good job. And we were kind of amazed, you know, but when we think about it, for me and Brandon, it's like some people are different. Me and Brandon, we both agreed, like, if we didn't have film school, we probably wouldn't be as good as we are right now.
Right.
Because it's like, you got to learn the basics and then learn how to do the rules and then learn how to bend them and break them to do it your own way, you know. It's like the hard deal.
What he just said, do it your own way, is the key for anybody that is in film school, is that you have to understand there's no formula to making a movie. There's no formula to writing a story. There is no textbook that can teach you how to do it. You have to just learn the basics and then go out and then do exactly what you just said, do it your own way. And then y'all did it great, and it wouldn't matter whether or not, you know, the talent's there. You guys are incredible.
No, I agree, and that's kind of what I was looking for. You know, I was a theater major when I first went to college, and, you know, we would see some kids in college who've been acting since they were kids, and then some people would, like a football player, come off the team, and because a director saw him, was like, oh, you'd be good for this part, and he would be amazing, no training whatsoever. So, and, you know, it's the same thing with Hollywood actors. Some of the best actors have never gone to acting school. Some have. So
some of the best directors
some
have
of the,
never been
same
to
thing,
film
yeah.
School.
So it's just a mix for everybody.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
it's like, you know,
Rebel Without a Crew.
What was it? Steven Spielberg?
Yes, it is.
Quentin Tarantino.
And he's my favorite director.
Yeah.
Who is?
Quentin Tarantino, Wes Anderson, Robert Rodriguez. Easily some of my favorite directors.
Yeah, it's
all
it's,
Texans, mostly.
When it comes to, like, you know, making these shorts your first time and stuff, it's kind of interesting, like, how you have nobody to be told, like, to tell you what to do.
Mm-hmm.
It's your movie. You can put as much heart into it, and which makes it such as, like, the most amazing thing about starting out in filmmaking is that you can spill your whole heart into this film and it might end up amazing, but you're still learning every step of the way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's what I think made, like, I know at least made our film so great, is because, like, everything that was happening on screen came from an extremely honest place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very personal also, apparently, yeah.
How much do you think your film school, I get how much you learn in film school, but how much have you had to break out of that?
Well, you have to learn the rules before you can break them. That's like the first thing we learned in film school. So if you go into film school and they teach you how it's supposed to be done and how it's been done for a long time, that then you can, like, go and, like, do whatever you want with those rules. Mm-hmm. But if you just go in and just make nonsense that, you know, you have no idea what you're doing, then it'll just come out as nonsense, you know.
Huh.
If that makes sense.
And that applies to radio, which he just defined our show.
Nonsense.
Yeah, but perfectly. We're damn good nonsense.
Yes.
I'm a fan.
We never learned any of the rules. That's what happened. That's what's wrong here. No, I think that applies to anything. I'm a newspaper writer. I actually do have a profession. And we had one person at the paper who had actually graduated from journalism school, and all she would ever do is tell us how we were doing everything wrong.
Well, it's the same thing.
You know, you have to learn to adapt. But what are some of the things you think, Billy, that you could have learned had you been to film school? Do you think that would have, or don't you even know because...
You know what?
It might have messed you up.
He said something that I mean, it's not a matter of agreeing with or disagreeing with. You know, you have to learn the rules. I never learned the rules, and I made a great film.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of the first and foremost making, you know, my daughter is an incredible singer and songwriter, and she plays guitar. There are people out there with great voice, but if you don't have the passion, you know, you, when you're singing, people can go, oh, that's a really nice voice. But if you don't have the passion, you can tell the difference between somebody that's passionately, you know, passionate about it. So there's, I don't think I could have learned anything from film school other than, you know, maybe some quicker editing tricks or something, you know, you know, how to, you know, what rack focus is, you know, but I learned all that, and I learned all that because I had a passion to make movies. And so, you know, for some people, you know, they need to have a textbook at first, and for other people, it's just something that they want to do and believe in doing. And
we are just about out of time.
Sure.
You are about to rewrite your short into a full-length script, hopefully film it next year.
Right.
And absolutely. The name of the film is again?
The Caravan.
The Caravan. So we will look for that.
You find The Caravan, Inciting Incident Films, on Facebook.
And since this is your first media appearance just before the film is released, even though it'll be in Hollywood, we expect you to do your first show here with us.
Yes. I'll have my people contact you.
Never forget you.
And
Same with you.
I want your people to get in touch with our people.
Done.
This would be our people.
My assistant. I'll have my assistants on it next week.
Right.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Thanks, you all, very much. Yes. And congratulations.
Thank
and
you
guys.
Very
much.
Seriously, when you have something else come out, let us know.
Absolutely.
We'll be back next week with more Lambda Weekly. Would you like to close this out? Because I can't.
I'm blank.
Well, real quick, the toy drive is still going on up to 4 o'clock. So come out here and donate some toys.
And she's blank.
I'm
blank. I have voice, but I have nothing to say.
Oh no.
It's scary.
It is.
Thanks y'all for being here.
Thanks guys.
KNON 89.3 FM in Dallas and Fort Worth, the voice of the people.
Business owners, tell KNON's listeners about your business. You can put your business or event on KNON. KNON currently has space available to run announcements for you. Tell KNON's listeners about your goods, services, nightclub, concert, or event. Help keep the voice of the people on the air while putting your information on the air. KNON's been named the #1 radio station in Dallas by both the Dallas Observer and D Magazine. Put your business with Dallas's #1 station. Call now for more information at 214-828-9500, extension 227, or extension 233. For more information, go to KNON.org and click on the Run Spots on KNON page. It's a great way for your business to support community radio while letting more people know about you.